Good evening. I'm Barbie Zelizer, director of the Scholars Program in Culture and Communication, and I welcome you to tonight's lecture by Aphra Kerr. Aphra Kerr is one of a handful of individuals who have taken communication as a field of study and applied it full force to one of the least understood applied environments of the contemporary moment, digital gaming. Called one of the most reliable voices in the gaming industry in Ireland, she's been involved over the last decade in doggedly tracking the production, consumption, and regulation of new media across the European landscape. Her training has been somewhat traditional, but the accolades given her work on Ireland and the global information economy have been anything but. As the holder of 3 degrees in communication studies, a BA, an MA, and a PhD in 2000 from Dublin City University in Ireland, her application of the field's conceptual epistemology to new digital horizons has established her voice as a singular one in the new media environment. Author of both The Business and Culture of Digital Games and of Broadcasting in the New Ireland, Kerr has published scores of peer-reviewed articles, book chapters, and research reports which analyze governance and user innovation, transnational cultural production, and migrant media practices across the digital media environment. These efforts have raised important questions about the extent to which new media differ from old, and under which circumstances those differences might be expected to grow or wither. Her work has also gained accolades beyond the academy. She stays grounded, serving as a concept developer, content editor, and manager of the website Game Developers. And over the past decade, she has been a European Union Research Fellow at the United Nations, a fellow with the Irish Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council, the University of Westminster, the University of Ulster Center for Media Research, and Dublin City University, and a consultant for the Institute for Prospective Technological Studies, one of 7 such institutes of the European Commission, and the OECD in Paris. She is also a founding member of the Digital Games Research Association, a committee member of Women in Games in Europe, and an organizer of the European Communications Policy Research Conference. It is no surprise, then, that already in 2006, a mere 6 years after she completed her doctorate, she was selected as one of the game industry's 100 most influential women in gaming. Kerr comes to us as a lecturer in the Department of Sociology, National University of Ireland, Maynooth, and as a research associate of the National Institute for Regional and Spatial Analysis. Tonight, she will speak to us on Games Are Us, Adventures in the Study of Digital Games. Please join me in welcoming her.
Thank you, Barbie, and thanks to the Annenberg School for hosting me and for arranging this talk. I'd also like to thank somebody who's not here, and that's Elihu Katz. It's in conversation with him that we came up with the first part of my title, Games Are Us, and I realized that one of his great pleasures is thinking up titles for talks. I liked it because, apart from the obvious play on Toys Are Us, it points to the fact that there are games and were games before digital games, but also the fact that if you take the us and you capitalize it, you can point to the significant influence that American companies are having in the global international games industry. So on our title slide here, you will see the top 10 selling games in the United States, video games in the United States this week. What can we say about video games and the United States looking at these titles? And hopefully you can see them from where you are. Well, we have 3 competing television console systems. We have the Nintendo Wii, we have the Sony PlayStation 3, we have the Microsoft's Xbox 360. We also have the handheld, the DS, Nintendo's DS, and their newly launched 3D DS. So we can see these titles, and you can see them, the DS here, faintly, probably the Xbox 360. Perhaps more significantly, I mean, when I looked at these first, I thought, goodness, what's the thing about dancing and sports in the United States? You know, Just Dance 2, Wii Sports. You can also see that in the game titles, that video games in the United States are very timely. I looked at these 2 weeks ago, and Tiger Woods Golf was not in the top 10, and NASCAR wasn't either. So I went looking, and yes, well, the US Masters has just been on, and NASCAR Rally seems to have taken off. I'm not sure if it's the season or not, but that seems to be timely and topical. A lot of the games are sequels. Crysis 2, Just Dance 2. So there was a previous iteration of that game that did well, and so they've decided to make a second one. Most of them are rated E for everyone, aimed at a general audience. Only one of the top 10 is aimed at a mature audience, and that's Crysis 2 for the PlayStation 3. What's also interesting if you look at the sales of games in the United States is that the top two Nintendo games sold almost 300,000 units between them. And there are only two games exceeding 100,000 units in sales in that week, but these are priced at $39.99. That's what you pay for your Nintendo DS games. It was Pokemon Black's fourth week at number one. Microsoft is not doing too badly. We have a couple of games here. Unfortunately, some of them are published by independent game publishers, so Microsoft doesn't get all of the revenue. There's a cut of it going to another independent publisher. But if you went to number 15, we find a game called Halo Reach, an iteration of a previously released game. It's 29 weeks in the charts. It's got cumulative sales of 6 million, selling at $59.99 a unit. Because Microsoft owns the hardware, it's also the publisher, and it's an internally fully owned development studio, full vertical integration along the value chain. They're getting a lot of that, apart from what's going to the retailer. This is what you can tell from looking at just the sales of video games. But of course, this doesn't tell you an awful lot about the cultures of production or the cultures of use. We can't tell very much just from the covers. We can find out some of these headline figures. And really what I want to talk to you tonight about is going beyond the content analysis and the covers and the marketing. And in fact, what you learn when you start looking at video games is that often there's quite a gap between how the games are marketed and what they're like when you experience them in gameplay. What these charts also don't include are some of the most rapidly growing areas of games in the games industry. That's mobile games and downloadable content, particularly flash downloadable web games. So when you look at charts and when you look at statistics, one of my first adventures in this space was trying to figure out what's included and what's not. And very often you need to look for what's excluded if you're going to start to understand cultures of production and cultures of use. Okay, well, it seems I came a year too early. Because next year in Penn is the year of games. If you don't know who Jane McGonigal is, you will very soon. This is the book that all of the undergrads next year are going to be reading, coming here, Reality is Broken. Jane McGonigal is a game designer. There's going to be a year of games next year in Penn. I'd love to think that I caused it, that there was some connection, but I don't think so. The interesting thing is that she has a very positive approach to games. She thinks that games and game techniques, gamification as it's called, can be applied to a lot of areas outside of entertainment and outside of games. Her thesis really is that gamification is going to occur in everyday life and in all aspects of life. And what that means to our lecturers for next year is that you are going to have to award experience points to your students for turning up to class. And, you know, you're going to have to give them rewards if they're going to level up and move on to year two. So don't say you haven't been warned. Okay. Well, tonight, as I was saying, I really want to, there are people in this audience who are very experienced games researchers, and there are people in this audience who don't know that much, perhaps, about games and games research. So hopefully you'll both bear with me. So there'll be a little bit of recapping for people who have done a lot of research. I really want to talk about kind of two aspects of my research. studying games as a cultural industry, and then moving on to studying developer-player relationships in an online community, which is a piece of research that we have just started to publish from, and we're really still in the middle of analyzing a lot of the data. And then we'll move on to talk about the implications. And these look like nice taster burgers, so I thought I've seen those here in the restaurants in Philadelphia. Okay, what's in a name? Well, one of the problems I encountered when I started to study in this area was that the initial writings, if you go back to some of Leslie Haddon's history of computer games, he talked about electronic games, and he included arcades in his description. When you're in the UK, a lot of people use the terminology computer games, PC games. Why? Because with the history of computer games in the UK, a lot of people grew up with the Commodore and the Spectrum, very kind of early microcomputers, and they associated games with the PC. And they started to talk about computer games. And that's actually still widely used in the UK when people are referring to the industry. But if you look at trade associations, and particularly publishers, they talk about entertainment software. Now, they have particular reasons for that, which I don't really have time to go into tonight, and it has to do with how computer games are categorized in the World Trade Talks. Should they be software, whereby they don't get categorized in with other cultural products and don't get associated with other kind of trade restrictions, particularly into Europe? Or do they get categorized in with media products and audiovisual products, where there's a long tradition of regulation in Europe of the flows of content coming from other countries? And so entertainment software is an interesting approach and terminology, but it's quite a loaded and a political term, as are quite a few of them. In the United States, video games seems to be the umbrella term that everybody uses for this field. And that probably has to do with the dominance, really, in this market of consoles and console platforms. And so hence, here in the United States, video game seems to be the dominant term and is used then as an umbrella term to include mobile and all these other kind of types of games. So it is interesting to look at the terminology that is used. But within the Digital Games Research Association, when it was established in 2000, people, because there was about 25 people from all over the world trying to decide what it was and what the terminology would be, and the only thing we could agree on was digital games. Hence the title of my book, and hence when I'm referring to it, I talk about digital games, to kind of signal it off from the fact that I don't do research on board games, even though I'm quite a fan of board games. And it seems to be the umbrella term that will include PC games, console games, mobile games, and downloadable games. Now, I'm not saying that's the only term to use. All I'm saying is when you use a term, be clear about why it is that you're using it, or at least explain to your readership. When I started in 2000, there was very little, say, when I started my postdoc on games in 2000, there was really very little written in academic terms on video games. There certainly had been literature before this on effects and a little bit of content analysis, and probably a pioneering like Janet Murray's Hamlet on the Holodeck. But there really hadn't been much looking at the games industry in particular, except for some pioneering journalists, Stephen Poole from the UK and J.C. Hertz here in the United States. And actually, these weren't bad because they clearly had all been to university and were using semiotics and some of the sort of tools that you think you teach to students and they forget the minute they leave. Well, actually, no, the journalists were starting to apply these to looking at digital games. In terms of academic studies of the industry, however, probably one of the first books to come out was the bottom one, Digital Play, by Stephen Klein, Greg DePuyter, and Nick Dyer Witherford, all Canadian scholars. And this was a book really started to look at the industry and had some empirical work in terms of interviews with game companies. And if you've ever tried to do research in the games industry, game companies are notoriously difficult to talk to. They rarely will give interviews. And so it is quite important to find people, and it's quite exciting for other academic scholars if people have done research where they've actually interviewed people in companies. So, but as you can see, and there's a more recent book now from two of the authors, Games of Empire, which came out in 2009. And this quotation is from Games of Empire. Video games are exemplary media of empire. And you can see what they're referring to in terms of the issue, literature, obviously, in terms of empire. But you can also see where they're coming from. They're talking about methods of accumulation based on IPR, cognitive exploitation, cultural hybridization, transcontinentally subcontracted dirty work, and they're referring particularly here to the production of the consoles and where they are produced, and then also world-marketed commodities. I think it's important their work, particularly Nick Dar Witherfer's, who looks at and uncovers where the hardware is produced. Mexico, China, Hungary. What are the production techniques? Who's producing these technologies in these countries? But actually, in my own work, I've kind of been more interested and more focused on the software industry, really, because those are the aspects which tended to be located in Ireland. And just finally, these are two other earlier books which started to look from a cultural studies perspective at the games industry. And you'll see James Newman has quite a few books out, and then Game Cultures by Helen Kennedy and John Dovey. Both of these have one chapter on the games industry, and John Dovey and Helen Kennedy did do interviews in one company, but what really, when I started out working, what it lacked for me was an understanding of the overall structure of the games industry, and who were the power brokers, like who controlled, where were the decisions made? We knew that there was a game company in Bristol that made these particular games, but who was the publisher and who was putting up the money? And that's really, those are the questions that really stemmed my initial research in this area. And so I had produced a couple of working papers before this, and in the nature of academic publishing, people were like, you know, I was informed that maybe people wouldn't be too interested in game companies from Ireland, and, you know, you need to make it, you know. Anyway, so I had the interesting process of writing academic textbooks. Really, what I started to do was draw upon some of the literature that I knew well, and that was political economy of the media. And I started to situate the industry within the broader cultural industries and look at how game developers and publishers went about producing games, who made the decisions. And it was pretty interesting to see that there was a lot of risk, a lot of uncertainty, just like in a lot of other industries. A lot of games made no money. A very small number of games made a lot of money. And the big thing for publishers and developers was to figure out how did you get those games that made all of the money and then make sequels. Right? But as you started to look at, if you go back to Nick Garnham's work, you go to Murdoch and Golding, and you look at games, there's high risk, there's high initial production costs and pretty cheap afterwards reproduction costs. And these goods are semi-public. So they fit within that kind of approach. They use similar strategies to reduce risk that you see in other industries, in other media industries. What do? They create artificial scarcity, particularly after the 1980s when there was a collapse in the games industry and there'd been an overflood of games coming into the market. What happened was that game publishers said, right, we were publishing too many games. We're going to restrict access to the platforms, particularly the console platforms. We're going to release fewer games every year, and we're going to keep the costs high. That's why you have to spend $60 or $40 for a handheld. So they create artificial scarcity in the market. Increasingly, to reduce risk, they're licensing real-world properties. So Tiger Woods, that golf game, probably wouldn't be quite the same, or maybe selling the same amount without Tiger Woods involved. But increasingly, we're also getting voiceovers from well-known actors, well-known music from well-known musicians. So we're seeing all sorts of crossovers with other existing media industries. And this is all about selling and reducing risk in the marketplace. We're getting sequels. We're getting releases of playable demos, beta testing and market testing in a way that we had seen in film and in a lot of the other media industries as well. Interestingly, particularly from the 1990s and into the 2000s, we're seeing increasing levels of vertical and horizontal integration. What does this mean? It seems that we're seeing fewer big publishers We have quite a lot of publishers, but we really only have probably about 10 really big publishers, particularly in the console space. And they started to buy up development studios. They were fed up with developers not delivering content on time. And in games, you need your content for the Christmas market. You know, most of the sales come at Christmas time. That means the games need to be delivered by September. They need to have gone gold. They need to be shipped to the markets. Timelines are incredibly important. And so to increase control of the creative process, publishers started increasingly buying up development studios. In the UK now, over half of the development studios are fully owned by publishers. Most of those publishers do not exist in the UK. They're based in Canada, in Japan or the United States, and one or two in France. And then we had these kind of funny artificial markets like the European, Middle East, Australia, blah, blah, something or other. And they started to make sure that the technologies of the console, so I can't buy a game here and bring it back to Europe because it won't play on my console at home. They also have regulated and structured the markets technologically as well as through business strategies. Okay. And more recently, what we're seeing is some interesting outsourcing and offshoring of certain elements of production. And this is particularly happening with online community support, which I won't be talking about here today. But we're seeing that certain elements of the production process are now being outsourced and offshored to cheaper cost locations. Okay. So when I started to study the games industry, I was drawing upon some perhaps well-known names to this audience, maybe, maybe not. Some French theorists on the cultural industries, Bernard Miege, also Patrick Flichy, and then Raymond Williams. I don't think anyone can go through communication graduate school without hearing about Raymond Williams. But perhaps the sociology of culture is not the key book maybe that everybody knows about. People talk about the television book and people talk about keywords, but they don't necessarily talk about the book, The Sociology of Culture. And I actually found this pretty useful in terms of thinking about the relationships in the games industry. Why? Because in fact, they started to, talk about and identify different models of production. Artisanal, where there was very little distance to the market and individual creator, and how cultural industries moved to market professional and corporate professional. And I had seen this happening quite a bit, or it seemed to me, in the games industry. Yes, there were still some indies, some artists producing games, but quickly and very quickly, to my mind, for an industry that was maybe, depending on how you date it, 40 years old, we had moved to that corporate professional era. And what that meant was that actually we were seeing increasing publisher control and, in fact, defining of games. So it went beyond them just funding the games. It actually was the game should be fit in this genre and should probably look like this, and we only need 5 racing games this, you know, over 2 years, so sorry, if you've got a racing game, we're not going to publish it, go somewhere else. That's kind of the relationship now between the publisher and the developer. The publisher is crucial to understanding how games get to market. And even in an era that's moving to digital downloads, and we're seeing a kind of scrambling around revenue models, I think it's quite interesting to look at the role of the publisher and how they're still able to maintain control in a lot of the different market segments. So when I started looking at the industry, a lot of the work just looked at the industry in terms of the technological platforms. And I tried to think, okay, well, if we look at the different models of production, can we think about the industry in any different way? And so now I'm going to put up a table and, you know, we'll see if it makes sense to you or not. It was included in my 2006 book. And what I tried to do was look at market concentration, look at revenue models, look at the degree of openness in the technology system. The console system is an incredibly closed system. If you want to develop from it, you need to be licensed by the platform manufacturer. They will do all the QA on the game, and they will tell you how and when you can manufacture, and in fact, they do the manufacturing for you. It's an incredibly closed technological system and very different to a PC game or developing for some of the other market platforms. So, this is what I came up with in 2006. In the first column, there are what I call the subsectors of the games industry. There's the consoled and handheld subsector. There's what I call the standard PC, which may or may not work anymore, we'll see. There's the massive multiplayer online games, and then there are mini casual games. And if we move on to column two, we have the market concentration. In the top one, we really have the big players, Nintendo, Microsoft, and Sony. We move to the next level, how they generally sell their product, which is still predominantly through retail, even though there's a move increasingly, particularly since 2006, for digital downloads. On the console platforms, it's very much proprietary technology. And in fact, what's quite interesting in my interviews is that even if you moved, were a developer for PlayStation 2, it didn't mean that you'd necessarily be able to develop for PlayStation 3, because the console could have changed that much that people's skills could be completely obsolete in the next life cycle. And we interviewed developers who were like, I can't, you know, PlayStation 3 is just, they've gone to multi-thread, you know, processors now rather than single thread, and we don't know how to optimize this, and we're like, so we're going to go over to the Xbox, or we, you know, so literally we might think it's just a new product on the market, but for the developers, this can be a whole new skill set that they have to learn as it moves from life cycle to life cycle. Okay, I mean, this is in the book, so, you know, I'm not going to go too much. What is interesting is that the final column, where I have 5 to 10 million, which was about the average price to produce a console game, the average is now $40 million for a console game to produce a console game. And if that is a AAA top-end title, it's more than $40 million to produce. So now we see we're getting in, you know, that's a bit more than indie film production. You know, we're talking, you know, this is serious amounts of money. So most publishers might publish about 15 games a year. You know, they really do restrict the numbers of games that they're putting out onto their platforms. But to me, the interesting thing coming from Ireland, where there were lots and lots of startups, was this mini casual area. And this is actually the area now we're seeing Facebook and all these other new platforms moving into, and in fact, Apple. And it remains to be seen what happens, but, you know, Apple is really starting to operate like the console platform owners were operating. You need to be a licensed developer, you need to pay them to get access, they'll take a revenue share of your game, even though it's a smaller amount in total. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. And Facebook will charge you to have your game in Facebook, and they'll want to take a revenue share. So this is quite interesting to see these new kind of developments. But, you know, I love my little casual games. And, you know, while everybody talks about the big AAA titles, you know, PopCap Games, who have a big studio in Dublin, this centre one, you see the little colourful one? You may have seen Bejeweled. There must be about 100 iterations, 3D, black and white, blah, 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 on every platform. This is their top-selling game, and their target market, their market research tells them, is women over 55. Farmville, if you've had the unlucky experience of being targeted in Facebook, Zynga, the publisher, is now a company that has just moved into the top 20 publishers in the world. So Facebook games can also make it big. Of course, games can be used for other things. And we've seen some of, particularly in the United States, this is an interesting use of games, where they take topical news stories and they start to make games out of them. I was trying to play one where I was the US taking on the WikiLeaks server. And I kept being hit by press releases from WikiLeaks, and I had to defend myself. So that's really worth taking a look at. But here's something that might, you know, be something that you may not have seen very much of. This is, again, in a political context, this is an interesting example. This is produced by an artist in Northern Ireland. They have taken the tools that were circulated with Counter-Strike, so essentially this is a mod, and they have taken imagery of all the political murals in Northern Ireland, and Belfast and Derry as the contexts for the game, and then media coverage of the Troubles, and they have made an artistic installation. It's an interesting use in terms of the entertainment technology for a very different type of end. Thank you. Well, actually, you can play as either loyalists or nationalists, so they're kind of politically. And the interesting thing is, you can wear a Celtic or a Rangers jersey. So if people know the conflict in the north, that was quite symbolically loaded. I mean, you know, a lot of people were giving out about this, but then other people were saying, well, actually, they're painting over the murals now. The H block where the prison that's depicted is about to be demolished. And we're saying, can we think of this also in terms of memory or somehow reappropriating into another context for a different audience? But I wanted to show it just in case everybody thought that, you know, all we get are the kind of AAA titles, the commercial titles, and that it can't be, these tools can't be used for some other purposes. When it's actually shown as an artistic work, it's an installation, and then there's different voiceovers, and they actually do a commentary on the media coverage of the Troubles while you also play in the game. So I think it's a very multi-layered kind of experience as you go through it. Okay. Now, I'm probably talking too much and I should move on a little bit. I'm not going to spend long with this because there are no statistics really of the games industry that you can rely upon. Mainly because, you know, nobody is really providing this and gathering these statistics free and making them freely available. This is in a report that's been produced by a research center in the European Commission, IPTS. It's probably hard to read, but I will just talk you across them here. This is between 2008 and 2012, so there are the different columns as we go across, the different colored columns. We start with console hardware and then console software. Okay, so often they're lumped together, the hardware and software. We move on to console hardware and software. We then move on to offline, and then what are probably two of the fastest growing ones in addition to console is online and wireless. These are global stats. These are produced by a French company, IDAT. I really would just use them as an indicative of some of the newer areas and the newer platforms rather than kind of taking the overall statistics, because most of the statistics in this area are incredibly unreliable. Did I mention that was one of my adventures? Okay, and it's also similarly with some of this, which is the critical role of the publisher. So you can get this report for $3,000 if you had the money. So I didn't, so I can't provide you with most of the detail that's in it. But what we can provide you with is just some of the nationality of the top 10 publishers. I'd maybe point those out to you. And what we're pointing out to you really is that 6 of the top 10 here are from the United States. 3 are Japanese and 1 is French. These are the main publishing companies. Now, this is kind of a funny survey because it's based on sales revenue, releases, scores on games, and a survey of the industry. But actually, it's pretty accurate if you compare it across a lot of the different types of surveys that are done. The new entrants, which have just moved in, this is 2009, are Zynga and Nexon, a company from South Korea, an online games company. Okay. But if you start to think about a political economy, you start to see that the top 10 publishers account for a lot of the sales and a lot of the value in bases. And particularly studies in the UK have shown, and in Europe, but it's also happening that there are fewer publishers making more money, if I was to summarize it, basically. And this is how, again, these are kind of figures, but I just want to point out. The top one there is Nintendo. This is revenue. So the top 3 here are Nintendo, Sony, and Microsoft because it includes hardware. It's hardware and software. And then we have the start of independent publishers and other media publishers who are publishing in games. So this is revenue in US dollars in millions. But the next one's probably more interesting, which is profit or loss. Nintendo is still making money, and Nintendo has made money on every Wii it has sold. It started to sell them, it didn't lose money. Microsoft and Sony lose money on the hardware. It costs them more to produce it, and they hope to make the money back on the software. Nintendo decided not to go with that strategy. It makes money on every Wii, and then it makes money on the software, and it makes money on its DS handheld, and now it has the 3D DS, which is making also significant money. Now, this year, Disney was up here with its games arm and studio, which is quite interesting. And actually, if we went back to the slide of the top 20, you'd see that Warner Brothers and some of the other big media companies have significant games arms. And what does that mean if you're an independent developer? Well, it can mean significant loss of control. I like this. I thought a grim gothic kind of environment racer might be kind of cool. But publishers weren't going to go for it. They didn't know how to market it. Okay. And this is an interview I did with a pretty successful PlayStation 1 studio who was trying to make a different type. They'd already made racing games, so they had a track record. But, you know, they were told they wanted straight racing and then they were going to put a motocross star in it. So they were going to put a real world property on top and then we'll sell it. So, well, they didn't, and that studio went out of business. So, anyway. I'm going to skip one or two slides because I can see time ticking along, and I, as my father says, the problem will be shutting me up rather than telling me. I wanted to just look at the structure of one publisher. This is Take-Two Interactive. It's the publisher of the Grand Theft Auto games, which you may have heard of. And the interesting thing, I suppose, in terms of Grand Theft Auto games is that the first games were produced in Scotland by an independent studio, and by about the fifth iteration, the publishers had decided this was a pretty successful franchise, and there was a bit of a bidding war, and eventually Take-Two Interactive and Rockstar Games purchased DMA Design in Edinburgh and renamed it Rockstar Games, Rockstar North. But Take-Two has two labels, as they call them, which is an interesting choice for their two different publishing arms. Take-Two has Rockstar Games Premium for GTA, Midnight Club, Max Payne, all of those different types of titles. And then it has its 2K arm label, which does its sports games and its casual games. And they actually have a different publishing arm for each one, targeting the different subsectors of the markets. They have their own US distribution company. They work with partners in other markets. But yes, you can see that only about 30% of their sales are outside the US, so the US is the main market for these games. And they employ about 2,200 employees, about half of them actually are outside the US. Last year they had 24 new releases, and a lot of these were iterations of games, so it might be Grand Theft Auto on the iPad, on the DS, on this and on that. 17 were by internal development studios wholly owned by the publisher. And there was only 3 new IPs. One of those was Birthday Bash for the Wii, which I think, maybe didn't take a lot of the creative effort of the studios. But I think it's interesting to look at how the publishers are structured, how they control production, and how they manage their portfolio of games. And this is one of their new games that's out, L.A. Noir, which is being previewed at the Tribeca Film Festival, which is a nice, interesting crossover between games and film. And of course, the British Academy has had a video game awards now since 2003, where they give awards on storytelling, on action, on music, scoring, and all these different things to international video games. Okay. I want to scoot a little bit. Okay. I did this research in a games company in 2001 where I thought, wouldn't it be really good to go into a games company and to do an ethnography of the games company if somebody would let me in? And lo and behold, this little company would. And they were above a pound shop, which I presume is a dollar store here, in a little back street in Dublin. Although we soon realized that methodologically it would be quite tough because they were all in this one office and they had the servers in there as well, and the temperature was about, 90 degrees Fahrenheit or more in this little room. So, nobody could stay in the room for very long, let alone the researcher who was trying to research what everybody else was doing. So sometimes you go into spaces that you want to research and there's all these other issues that you never realized would be there before you go into it. But these guys were producing an RPG for PC. There were a group of friends, 13 full-time people working in this game company, and they had got venture capital funding because they figured as a new development studio, no publisher was going to take a risk on them. So they thought if they got venture capital funding to produce a prototype to then pitch to a developer, they would have demonstrated their skills and so taken a lot of the risk out for the publisher. And so that's what they did, and they started developing a prototype of the game to take and pitch to the publisher. And you can see there was some Irish influence in some of the screenshots that they were developing. And we took a kind of an STS approach to this because we thought, okay, we need to look at, and this was, they were doing a PC and they were doing online and they were trying to decide what role the server would have in controlling the relationship between the developers and the game players. And they were trying to decide who would do what. And the initial kind of company they were working with was an ISP in Germany. So there was this development studio in Dublin, and then there was a partner in Germany, and there was venture capitalists in Ireland. And they were trying to control this network, as well as then a server, which was managing beta testing with external players. So developing this PC game, even for the prototype, became quite complicated just in terms of managing the relationships internally and externally. And some of the roles were given over to technology, and some were kind of kept by the kind of major partners in the studio. And when we talked to them about who they thought they were developing the game for, and they said, well, it's kind of for people like us. It's going to be picked up by people who are interested in fantasy and strategy. And it's aimed at the PC online player, average age 27, high income earner, probably male. And I said, well, did you think about females might play it? And they said, not really. Didn't really consider it enough, probably not enough. Because I was female asking the question, I think they added enough. And then I asked them about how they were managing their relationships with their players. And they said, well, we started off with 1,600 people, but we just couldn't do that, right? These are 13 guys, and maybe only one or two of them are trying to work the beta testing. And they're like, there's too much going on. How do you do this? It's all well and good trying to engage with your users and players, but when they're telling you've got 20 zillion bugs in your software and you can't fix them all, it becomes very difficult to manage this relationship. And this actually is kind of a precursor to what's happening now with MMO games, where people are trying to manage these large communities. You know, it's not straightforward to manage online relationships with these game players. And this is something I think a lot of other media industries will probably be learning as well. You know, so then they said, well, we tried to limit it, and we said, okay, because our servers were going up and down and people were getting kind of annoyed, so people just started popping in every week. But they were trying to do the best that they could with the resources that they had, but they really didn't know how to manage these relationships. The thing about, you know, the target market being primarily male was something that came up in a lot of my other interviews as well, primarily aimed at the PC online player. Average age 27, high income. Fortunately, I always get these in my answers, I guess. Maybe I should do online interviews or something like that. Unfortunately, generally male. Female games market is a market that's not very well defined, hasn't been well serviced. Recently, in the last 2 or 3 years, certain game publishers have attempted that market, but our game isn't a Barbie game. And the default is always that we're not pink and we're not a Barbie game, and we don't know what works in that market. And this is always the strategy to kind of say, okay, we don't know what that is, so that must be the marketing department's role or the publisher's role, but how are we going to understand it and know what it is? And this comes up over and over and over again, and it's something that the industry is really struggling with. And one of the ways it started to deal with it is through new interface technologies. Another way is through online generated content, kind of saying, okay, the players can do some more of the changing of the representations of the characters or even of the backgrounds. But it really is something that a lot of companies are struggling with, except for perhaps Bejeweled and PopCap. But, you know, not all Irish companies fail. And then this is a company that some people may have heard of, Havoc. Certainly, if you've ever looked at the back of a AAA game title, you will have seen that Bullsaw logo, which is the company logo. They do physics middleware. That is how you get the flapping cloth and the ripples on the water and crashes that look physically like crashes. These are seriously... Well, you know, it's a university spin-off out of a physics maths department, Trinity College in Dublin. And if you've ever played Guitar Hero, the reason you can really get it to work like a guitar is because of Havoc's physics and middleware. But even Havoc, who's Havoc's target market? Who do they market their software to? Game development companies. And when they started up first, their first couple of ad campaigns were banned. Because they had bull saws ripping through condoms, and they had pills to kind of simulate physics, and physics experiences were out of this world. And I talked to them about this, and said, yeah, but you know, look who we're marketing to. It's high-octane guys who are in their 20s working in game development companies. That's who we have to sell to. And I was like, okay. And you get quite a lot of this, you know. You get the nice marketing now around casual games and around other AAA games, but if you go to a game developer conference, you want to have your testosterone suit on, you know. As a female going, you really want to be prepared for what you're getting yourself in for. And a lot of companies are saying, you know, well, if I'm going to work in this space, I have to talk to these people. This is what I want to market with. So these are the sorts of kind of discourses that you end up engaging with when you're talking to people who work in this space. Okay, maybe 5 minutes? I don't know. Do I need to? Okay. All right. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about users. Okay, and then just finish up. So I'll keep this brief. We were doing another project around 2004-05 called New Media, New Pleasures. And we were going into people's homes, talking to them. Now, I'm not a great drawer, so I relied on squares and lines here. But what was interesting for us when we started to look at cultures of consumption and use is that sometimes as media scholars we forget what people do in their homes and the messiness, you know, what is watching television or what is playing games. And, you know, we were going into these different households going, the telly's kind of in one corner and now there's something else in the other corner, which tended to be a PC. And so we were also seeing, and everybody in the academy were talking about convergence and how everything was converging. But you go into people's homes and you're seeing more and more technology. I mean, you know, under the TV here we had our VHS, digital recorder, DVD, PlayStation 2, GameCube, and Dreamcast. Right? They'd move the chair and we put that in kindly. We have over in one corner VHS, DVD, CD-ROM storage, you know, and we had couches all the way around. So there'd been to be a complete multiplication of technologies in people's home rather than a convergence into a kind of particular technology. One of my friends indulged me and let me take pictures of their house, and I thought, my, how do you work your remote controls? You have about 6 remote controls. And they had a Kindle book, and they had an e-book, and they had their digital recorder, and they had a netbook for doing their streaming audio radio. And I thought, whatever happened to convergence? And, you know, sometimes we go into the academy and we forget that we need to look at what it is that people are doing in people's homes. And you know, when we talk about control in new media, you know, is it really about just pushing buttons? Is this the control that we're giving to our users? Is that what an active audience is in the new media age? Is it just about, you know, letting people select more content on more platforms? Is that what it's all about? We wrote a little bit about this, about trying to think about what were the pleasures of new media in 2004 and 2005. There's a working paper where we review a lot of the literature, and you can download it from DCU, from STEM at DCU, where we looked at the relationships between immersion and control and performance in terms of play, and what was the pleasures of play in new media. Now, I know, I mean, Roger Silverstone has written about play in terms across all different media in his book, Why Study the Media? And, you know, this is not something new, but we were interested in looking, and I was interested in how play worked in terms of games and what kinds of control we were giving to game players and how they were actually experiencing it. So I'm really just going to kind of finish with a couple of quotations of some players about their talking about gameplay. And, you know, it's always nice to let interviewees talk rather than have the academics kind of talking all the time. So when people were playing games, this is a female interviewee I had. I played to compete against somebody else, or to compete against a computer, or to compete with myself. If it's not challenging, you just get bored. So part of the pleasures of playing game is being able to compete, but it doesn't have to be necessarily just against the computer. It can also be, and you know, 2005, we were starting to see people playing online games quite a bit more. Like this guy, he says, I practiced my ass off. This is somebody practicing offline to then go online to compete. Okay, so I practiced my ass off. Let's say we're doing a qualifying run for our race and you only had one lap to get it right, and just the sense of competition is like walking out onto a soccer field and everybody watching you. And you knew they, so there were spectators watching the performance online. So there were real people watching the performance in the house as well as other people online that they were competing against. And sometimes we forget about the stuff that goes on in people's houses, you know, the people watching and the spectators and the enjoyment that they might have. You know, and this guy's talking about his nerves. Now, this house, they actually had put in a local area network in the house because the internet connection was so poor in the area. So they had computers in all the different bedrooms, and they'd set up a network in the house. So this is why they were able to say, I can see what they're saying. I can see them online, but I can also walk into their rooms and see what they're doing. And this, again, is you know, here's where it crosses interesting boundaries. There are Swedish and English and German people, and they're all really cool, and I chat with them, and you went out and you had, just like you, you know, went out and had a chat. Talk crap, hung out. You'd be racing for 2 or 3 hours, and you'd be chatting away. And I think everybody agreed the game saved them about €400 in going out money. And you could hear people's doorbells in the background, and they say, hang on, this is to the other people online. And then they'd bring a guest along, and then they'd join in and they'd start playing. So here we're getting to some of the pleasures of play. And in the literature, we talk about control and controlling play and immersion and performance. And then sometimes we forget about both the online and the offline people who are engaging in this. And this is the cultures of use that are getting performed and enacted through the technologies that often, I think, a lot of the research and the play testing, probably misses out on, and perhaps a lot of the game companies may not be doing this type of research where they're seeing really what it is that people are doing in these worlds. Maybe I should just finish on this. So when you watch TV, this interviewee said it's a passive thing. In a game, you're actually physically manipulating. I know some scholars would not necessarily take TV as being a passive thing, but you bear with the interviewee. You're actually engaging in a social event. So this is taking us beyond just thinking about the text or what you see on the game cover to thinking about how the text or the game is being used by people in this space. You might think about it as a space of possibilities that then people are taking control of and starting to use. And then I love that they could put up Senegal and beat Brazil with some practice, because of course, this is the kind of fictional space that people are moving into. So, just to kind of, we've been moving on now, we've been doing some research in massive multiplayer online games, we've been looking at cheating, we've been looking at punishment and crime and various different things, which we're just starting to think about and publish about. But hopefully I've given you a flavor where you can start to think about games as a cultural industry, how it relates to other media industries, and how it's embedded, really, even if it may not be what everybody's talking about in terms of media scholars, it's definitely embedded in the media industries as we see it. When we think about transnational cultural production, unlike in film where some scholars are saying it's kind of controlled by Hollywood as a center of production, in games we have two centers. We have the United States and Japan. I mean, it remains to be seen what happens with Japan, just given what's going on at the moment. But as you look at the main publishers in these industries, what you have are two poles, particularly in console and PC. But the new emerging actors are coming out of South Korea and China. This is where, at the moment, the kind of new tier of publishers that are moving into this space. And they're particularly active in online games, and they're trying out new revenue models, like microtransactions. So it's free to play, but then you trade on the goods in the game. And these are starting to come into the US markets, but not as much so far. But I think kind of watch this space, because that is where a lot of companies, they want to cut out the retailers, the Toys R Us, the Best Buys, the Walmarts, they want to cut those out of the value chain, and they're thinking, maybe digital downloads, maybe microtransactions, maybe this is the way to go. In games, we can see that even for the developers, they're starting to have to think about their players and manage relationships with them. We've seen examples, and scholars here have done work where companies are giving tools to their game players to produce their own content, and now companies have to think how to manage that. And now we have huge online communities, thousands of players. So essentially, game development companies and publishers are moving into service management. This is a different space for a lot of companies, but it may be a kind of harbinger of where other media companies may end up going in the future space. And while I didn't talk a lot about diversity issues in this talk, I have written about it before. There are clearly issues around gender diversity, which the industry is struggling with, but there are other issues around diversity and cultural diversity and localization of content, which are starting to bubble up. So I think diversity is another kind of major issue that the industry is trying to grapple with and deal with. Okay. I think I should leave it there. Congratulations, you've probably got about 2,000 experience points at this stage. And I'm happy to take your questions now. Thank you.